materials in giving some further discussion. Since next week is a holiday, so I'd like to give you more slides today. So you can have like the one more week to stay at home and give you some slides.
Okay.
So it's fine, we just keep going. Let's quickly talk about some like fundamental, and then we move to the different kinds of the contract. So number one, like during the contract, we need to talk about risk. Who should bear or who should share more risk? You will find like the following contract try to talk about this issue. So if like the buyers or suppliers, some of them, if they want to transfer their risk, how should they do? And sometimes like the buyer doesn't want to purchase so much quantities once because like they will face a financial risk. You can imagine that if they purchase a lot of raw material, a lot of products, if they cannot sell out very well, what will happen? All these products will become inventory. All this inventory will be idle. And then eventually those money will be lost. How this buyer will become, they will be dying. So ideally, they will try to limit their purchasing behavior. Maybe every time they order just a little bit. Make sure this is a kind of like a, they can be sell out. But for the supplier side, it will become another trade-off. For supplier side, if you're facing one buyer, every time just purchase a little bit, it's not easy to handle. You can imagine that if you have a factory, no matter how large size of the order, you still need to open your factory. You need to hire some worker. You need to open your assembly line. Then, and electricity, lots of the rental your warehouse. So you have still need to, so if the order is very small size, which is not efficient, you want to order a lot. So it becomes a kind of bargaining power. Sometimes like if buyers purchase a lot, supplier can be no risk. So if supplier takes some risk, what should they do? So background is, in some situation, buyer limiting their risk. So they only purchase a little bit. In that case, supplier may be no risk. I just make sure order, I receive an order, I start to purchase. We say a poor system, poor supply chain. In a poor supply chain, supplier certainly they have no risk. I receive the order, I start to produce my product. But in that case, you can imagine that buyer may be very limited their purchasing behavior. And also you will reach no economic scale. So sometimes supplier want to push the buyer purchase a little bit more. How to push? How will you think?
Discount.
Okay, give them discount. Maybe. Okay, number one, give them a discount. What else?
Advertising. Advertising.
Advertising, okay, good. Yeah, help them to do some advertising. What else? So if you are a supplier, you want to push the buyer purchase a lot. Promotion may be similar to previous one, yes. What else? Cost down. Cost down. Maybe your sales price will be lower. Maybe. Think about standing on the other side. If supplier give you some promotion, if you were a buyer, would you like to purchase a lot? Or let's say I will help you to do the testing. Would you like to purchase a lot? What's the issue here is that for the buyer side, they purchase a lot. The problem is they cannot sell out. So idea is, can you help them to dealing with the reverse logistics? Which means the return issue, return policy. I think that's more important in practice. So if you can guarantee a buyer, okay, no matter how much you order, ideally. You can guarantee, okay, no matter how much you order, if you cannot sell out, you can fully return back. Well, in that case, all buyers will purchase unlimited purchase, facing possible, then supplier will bearing a lot of risk and facing a big loss. So key issue is how to balance that. So I mean, all contracts talk about like risk balance and risk sharing. So yeah, just to be a very crazy case. Alright, so buyer links to their quantity, they're facing another risk, out of stock, out of shortage. So which means that like, they may not be able to handle all this. Alright, so let me give you a first contract is buy back contract. Similar to what I mentioned before, but not truly. So you can see the condition term here is supplier agrees to buy back unsold goods for some agreed price. Not 40 back. 40 back price back, I mean, no one wants to be a supplier. But maybe you can try to negotiate a certain level price, maybe between the listed price to the your minimum cost. So you can try to see, you can guarantee. So in that case, buyer may have some incentive to order more because you have the buy back contract to support them. So buyer may be, okay, I'm a little bit able, encouraged to do so. So buyer can increase some length. And also, if they buy more, they can decrease the probability to facing the shortage because they have more product on hand. Also, compensate the supplier, supplier will take more risk. So in this, under this contract, if this is a poor system, poor means make to order, they receive the order, they start to produce. In that case, if you use this backpack contract, you can imagine that supplier definitely increase their risk. Buyer can decrease their risk. So looks very okay. Mm-hmm. Only supplier will have some benefit and risk balance again. So for the supplier side, if they can push buyer purchase more, they can reach more economic scale, which means they can lower down their production cost. Then they can create other space for the other extra profit. So it looks very good. What's the drawback? Every contract has the bright side and dark side. So bright side looks okay, win-win strategy. For supplier, we have a chance to induce you purchase more and lower down our production cost. For buyer side, we can escape the shortage problem.
We cannot ask the value of the product.
I would say
depends. The value is going
to decrease. The value? Maybe not. Because like, it's just between a supplier and buyer. And maybe final customer on the end. So maybe we will not face this. Because final end product, the normal customer maybe not know the whole detail about the negotiation. This is just between the supplier and the buyer. Buyer may be the one middle part. This do a little bit like the package and sell out. Maybe. So what's the drawback for this contract?
Supplier is so
related to supply chain. Yes, a little bit. I would say that key points is like that right now supplier will facing some trick. What kind of trick? If you were a buyer, how to get more benefit from this contract? Think about it. If you were a buyer, this buyback contract is like the you order more than your expectation. If you cannot sell out, the supplier will buy back based on certain amount of agreed price. If you were a buyer,
increase the inventory.
You will increase, but sometimes you will try to use the other trick. Okay, let me show you the. Okay, before I show you the trick, introduce another. One more, and we talked about the drawback. Another second contract we call the revenue sharing contract. So in that case, suppliers still want buyer to purchase more, and buyer can share some bad revenue with the supplier if they agree. So then supplier will provide some discount for the wholesale price. So buyer can use the lower cost to purchase their raw material. But eventually they need to share the revenue back. This is what we call the revenue sharing contract. why we need to design this kind of contract. Some buyers, they want to purchase more, but they are a little bit afraid they cannot sell very well. So you just say, okay, at the beginning, I try to lower down your purchasing cost. So maybe you can save your money to do some advertisement, to do some promotion. But eventually, if you sell a lot, maybe more than a certain amount, you need to share your revenue back to compensate my discount at the beginning. So that's another function we call revenue sharing. So buyer transfer some revenue from each unit. So back to the supplier. So second one we call revenue sharing. Number one we call buyback. Number two we call revenue sharing. Alright, so still they have some drawbacks. Very similar to the first one. Anyone want to guess? If you were a buyer, how would you do? Certainly I will start to purchase more because you give me some discount at the beginning. I can purchase more. Then I start to sell. Key point is, will you really share your revenue back? Yeah, someone is starting. But how to avoid it?
Make a fake report.
Number one, give landlord another report number. But it's very difficult to operate because right now I support you so many items, maybe I can control it. What else you could do? In the buyback contract or revenue sharing contract, they have one trick to operate if you were a buyer. Let me jump this to first. Okay, drawback. Let's talk about drawback. Number one. I say number two first, okay. You can see, like the if you were a retailer, you were a buyer or a retailer, you have the two different sources of the raw materials, two different sources of the sourcing of the products. You may start to push the products, not guaranteed with the buyback contract. What does that mean? You were one buyer, you're facing two suppliers. One supplier tell you you can have this contract for protection, another one is not. Maybe buyer will start from to sell their products from the no protection first, because another one, if you cannot sell out, they can be protected. Alright, so for the supplier provide this kind of contract, for this contract, they will suffer some another small risk, because you start to sell their competitors' products first. So you start. What do you mean buyer help to increase the competitors' market share rate? So at the beginning you want to share this contract to induce their purchase more, but eventually they start to push products not under this protection. That's number one possible. Similar to the revenue sharing, they start to push competing products first. Why? Because like the products not under the revenue sharing contract means like they don't need to share the revenue. If they are quite the same, for example, like Coca-Cola versus Pepsi, maybe Coca-Cola under the protection, Pepsi is not. If I were a buyer, I would start to push the Pepsi first because I can get the truly revenue in my pocket. But Coca-Cola, I need to share maybe 5% back. In that case, maybe I would let Pepsi go out first. So if you facing this situation, both of contracts were facing this trick. Retailer side may not really care about your products. They try to push your competitor's product. That's number one. Number two, then you have increasing your reverse logistics cost. Why? Because you say you have a backpack, which means like the unsold out items will be returned. Then you create another trouble for yourself. You have to deal with those kind of expiration date products, or maybe just have new generation, so these are all styles products you need to sell out. So it push you in another risk. What else? Revenue sharing. You may not be really monitoring the truly sales, so maybe they were hidden some value. Maybe. So you cannot be get a truly revenue expected to receive. So that's the drawback for these two contracts. You will find like ideally they wish to push some situation, but sometimes in practice they fall on the other downside. Okay, first two contracts. Okay, so any comments or please?
Do they also consider the present value
time? Yes, when we talk about present value and versus the future value, which means like the listed price may be the present value, which they can be sale right now, but in the future value, yes. And also sometimes like that we need to calculate the safety stock cost. So we need to compare the difference between the present value and the maybe 1 year later future value to see like how difference between this cost. Yeah, yes. Okay, what else question, please?
About the safety cost, the buyer had to return the book to the supplier. So about the safety cost, in the contract, buyer and supplier can share or just
it depends, but I would say maybe buyers may, but yeah, it's a very good viewpoint. Who should pay for this logistics cost? Yeah, it's a good issue. I'm not so sure. I know in practice, either way, possibly happen, occur. Okay, so possibly, maybe buyer will share. Because compared to the product total cost, maybe logistics cost is very tiny value. Transportation fee sometimes compared to the product value will be quite different. Transportation fee may be a little bit minor. Yeah. So maybe then you may not really care about this transportation. But yes, it will create another tiny cost amount for the whole system. Yeah, what else? So it was the first two contracts, looks good, but still have some downside. And those downside, how to control that? So for example, if I want to launch a buy back contract, how, or revenue sharing contract, how to avoid that? If you were a supplier, now back to standing on the supplier side. If you were a supplier, I want to use these two contracts to push your buyer to purchase more, but I want to avoid those kind of drawback. How could you do?
Forecast.
Or just, okay, we don't want to use these two contracts. But that's business. Business, sometimes you have to take some risk, please.
Yeah, maybe like for the first drawback, maybe an arrangement where the reverse logistics system, the costs for the reverse logistics system are shared between the buyer and the supplier.
Yeah, maybe you can put, okay, very good, similar to the previous viewpoints, maybe you can try to tell them you should share the reverse logistics cost.
Yeah, and then that's when you that there is also an arrangement such that the products that are pushed to the retailers, maybe they have certain percentage of the products that use the products that come from the supplier.
Maybe. But it's one possible. Yeah, I would say try to think about how to avoid. So that's one possible strategy. Standing on and try to reduce your reverse logistic cost. What else you could do?
If you were a supplier, you want to launch these two new contracts. You also want to avoid this kind of drawback. How could you do?
Do you need the quota? Do you need the quota
of buying back? Okay, very good. Now we talk about quota. That's another contract. Okay, so some people start to talk about you have to guarantee the quota. I want you to launch this two contracts, but at least you have guarantee some. You have to stay on some of my products. Not always agree with you. That's the one pass forward. What else? And you can try to monitor if your supplier is shipped and see if they have a different price, listed price within their shirt and see. For example, like Pepsi and Coca-Cola, you can check out what kind of price they put more for Pepsi. And maybe you can try to monitor them for the reader side. Not really on the system, maybe can help. But I mean, these two projects, these two kind of like the contracts, still good, but still need to mix with the other contracts. So back to that. The third one I would like to share today is the quantity flexibility contracts. What does that mean? Supplier provides a fully refund. So previous one is like a partially refund. This one is fully refund for return items. But they have a certain quantity to make sure it's not big loss. So still I can push you to purchase more. And if you can ask, it's similar to a buyback contract, but a little bit different. Buyback means like the partially agreeable price. This one is there, okay, I can fully refund to you, but just a limited amount. So which means like if you exceed this kind of amount, I win for now. At least you can control your lose. So buyback contract can follow by this kind of like other contract. Make sure you have a quota to limit it up. The first one we call a sales rebate contract. What does the meaning of a rebate? Or anyone try to, has anyone experienced this before? When I say in the United States, we purchase a lot of the rebate items. Rebate means like at the beginning, many days you spend $100, but if you really purchase this and fill out some like the questionnaire, and then we will give you $50 back, because this is a rebate. So for example, okay, previously I have a picture when I found the United States website. What kinds of incentives? So you could see a retailer, they have a direct incentive. This first customer will see, okay, the different channel. Channel 1 is a normal price. Channel 2 is normal price, but if you really purchase, the supplier can give you like a 50% rebate. So then customer will feel more incentive to purchase in the channel 2. And retailer can give like the retailer can increase the sales, so which means they can order more because it stimulates their business. What's the advantage? For the retailer side, if any supplier provides this kind of rebate, they can easy to sell. Because like you can get maybe certain discount. For the supplier side, they have some very more risk because we need to pay more cash to the customer to encourage them to purchase more. So why any drawback for that or any advantage? Looks like the rebate is facing some challenge. Supplier need to pay a lot of cash if the customer really purchases through this channel. But the good thing is they can receive a lot of cash at the beginning. So most of the company, if they play a rebate just mainly because they want to get a lot of money at the beginning, they use this money to invest to other ways to get money back. They mainly operate a cash flow. So you can, but again, like the, if you are interested, you can try to look for one company in the United States. Yeah, it's true. I believe.
And retailers
that have
advantage, so they can sell the product.
It's true. Yeah, if you want to find, for example, Coca-Cola is in Mongolia. Okay, they have the rebate, so they can find the name with other brand of Coca-Cola. And in the United States, some companies are successful through operating this kind of rebate because they can easily to get lots of money at a very early beginning. For example, like the iPhone. If you go to a normal channel, there are normal listed price. If you go to another channel, they give you 10% rebate. And then some people will try to go through the channel too. So they can easily get lots of the iPhone sales at the early beginning. What's the benefit? Number one, they can get lots of money at a very early stage. Number two, their channel can sell a lot of iPhone. What does that mean? Other channel may not be so powerful. Then this channel will suddenly increase their market share rate. What's next? They can go back to bargaining with Apple. Whoa, I sell a lot. Maybe 50% of iPhone sales through my channel. Could you give me more discount? You see? So that's why they upgrade the rebate. But some company may have a fail case, which means that money cannot turn over very good. So they are the two different ways. Some companies like to operate this way. Suddenly they can, because the consumer willing to or want to purchase the iPhone may be very limited and fixed every year. If you can grab most of them at the very beginning, which means all other channels will lose their business. So it depends. So lots of contracts have different interesting issues. Okay, so four contracts. We quickly introduce the plan. Oh, okay. Yeah, this is all I have. oh, okay, this company new egg. They have like a, for example, like 100 rebates. You finish everything, they will, you see the normal price around 379, and they give you 100 rebates, so it becomes only 279. It's in the United States. They want to sell some electronic device, the notebook. Okay, then some people will say, okay, I can get 100 rebate. What's the disadvantage? This company is very famous case study company. If you go back home to Google that, this company right now is going bankruptcy last year. Because they can offer very well, so they, the money can turn very bad. Number two is, lots of customers argue with them, their rebate cannot fulfill very well, which means that like every 10 cases only fulfill maybe half of them, which means your customer not really receive this rebate. So they have lots of like fighting with that. So eventually this company, if you go back home to Google, like, has go bankrupt from last year. All right, for contracts. Is that okay for you? We talked about a push to order before, the first phone contract, which means that they receive the order, they start to purchase, they start to produce. Which means like who is more powerful, the buyer side or supplier side?
Supplier.
Really, supplier or buyer? Think about it. If you were an aircraft company, you are Boeing or you are Airbus, you receive the order, you start to produce. Which one is more powerful? Usually, maybe buyer, because I have two choices. I can choose either Boeing or choose Airbus. If you can actually do that, I can switch to another one. But for the Boeing or Airbus, they have to wait for the order. So in that case, if you cannot push, maybe they will lose their business. So we call that. But the other one, what if we talk about a push system, push supply chain, make you stop. Push to supply chain means the supplier produce in advance, they start to sell. You may think like in that case, supplier may be a little bit weakness, but actually it's not. The supplier, they are there to produce in advance to sell, which means they have a very strong feeling, or they have a very high confidence, they can, must be can sell out. So you will find like the Apple, the iPad or iPhone, they all produce in advance, and then start to sell, because they believe they can you can sell these kind of products. Okay, so you can find some interesting things. So let's talk about it a little bit, push supply chain. The first contract is very similar to the buyback contract, but this time we call it payback contract. You can compare what's the difference. Buyer try to pay some agreed price for any unit. So supplier or manufacturer, they produce but not really purchase. What does that mean? So supplier, they produce something in advance, which means they may not be willing to purchase, to produce more. They only want to produce certain amount of items at the beginning. But if you are a buyer, you may face a high demand in the market. You want to go back to say, could you produce more? They may not be willing to do so, because they have already produced in advance. In that case, maybe buyer want to increase the probability of the supplier they can produce more in advance. But for the supplier side, they will bear more risk. Number one, they may, based on their previous historical sales, to produce so many of level of the products. Maybe if they produce more, but eventually no one really buy for them, they will face an inventory problem. So they don't want to do so. So for the buyer side, then we want to encourage them to purchase more. So they use this payback contract, which means you can produce more. And if I do not really procure with you, maybe I will pay some compensated money for you, but still agree some price. So you will see like in that case, buyer's list increase, supplier risk reduce. Okay? You can imagine. So all these contracts talk about who is standing on the powerful side, who has more power to request another side to do so, to do the different things. Another term is similar to a revenue sharing, but we call it cost sharing. Very similar idea, but standing on different side. So buyers say, you can do whatever production, I try my best to share some of your production cost, and then to encourage you to produce more. All right, so two things. So similar to the previous one, they also have a drawback. Payback or co-sharing, they still have a dark side. Ideally, the buyer wants to push supplier to produce more, because this is the producing advance, made to stock. So they want you to produce more. What's the drawback? Similar to previous one. Cost sharing, you go back to think about the risk sharing or buyback contract. They were facing challenge. So similar to that. And I think like the key points is they are standing on asymmetric information. So buyer and the supplier, they cannot share the information with each other. We talk about information sharing. If they can share, how will it happen? All product sales will be very clear. All these contracts will work very well. Unfortunately, no one really wants to share the real number of the sales. So some information becomes asymmetric. Then all these contracts will become have some like the drawback to operate. The keyword is that possible to have the clear information? No. In practice, I would say no, it's very straightforward, because in practice, no one wants to share their business secret with each other. No matter they are partners. So number one is asymmetric information, they cannot have the. Certainly another thing is, sometimes even for the forecast, they have a different forecasting number. Buyer and supplier may not have the same forecasting numbers, which means they will have a different forecasting error. Maybe buyer expect next year should have more demand, but supplier will be standing on more the other way, so they have a different way. So idea is we design a better contract based on the previous idea. Actually, that's my previous homework which we have today. Last year, I started to ask my students, can you try to design a new contract? When you look at so many contracts and you found lots of drawback, will you design a better contract based on your thinking? That's my previous homework series. Now this time, I decided, so I give you another homework too. So, reduce your burden. All right, and if I finish, I quickly go the other two. Capacity reserve.